Welcome to Wallingford Over the Edge. My name is Paul Shardullo.
And I'm Don Kennedy. Tonight we're just going to have a little discussion. Just Paul and I, we've been having coffee on a routine basis.
Yep.
And what we've been doing is trying to figure out how do we manage the tax system.
Yes.
And what do we do to encourage citizens to actually go out and talk to town hall, talk to the councilors, talk to the mayor, yep, so that we stop this crazy spending. Anyway, Paul.
In terms of in answering the question of, you know, why are we here? We all have our own motivations, but one of the reasons that I got involved, or I chose to get involved, in local politics and the budget process really relates back to a period and specifically a town council meeting about 10 plus years ago. Up to that point, I'd lived here for 25 or 30 years. I never really participated or paid much attention, frankly, to the political process and how government worked. But this particular evening, I was reading the newspaper, and there was an article commenting about the fact that there was a council meeting that night, and the council was going to vote on the expansion of the library in Wallingford. And we were going to potentially spend $15 million to upgrade the library. And I'm a big library buff. I've been there many times. I always use it a lot. And I was kind of shocked that we were going to consider making that kind of a big expenditure.
Investment.
Because at that time, we were in a situation where we had just approved a $70 million upgrade to all of the schools, which included putting libraries in all of the schools. Plus, we have a seniors library. We have a library in Yalesville. And I personally didn't feel that the existing library, which was only 20 years old, was fully utilized. So that's what moved me. That was the very first time I decided, you know what, I'm going to go to this town meeting. And I went to the meeting, and interestingly enough, I was a minority of one at the meeting. I spoke out in opposition to it. I just didn't feel we needed it. I didn't feel we could support it. And another interesting factoid is that at that time, the mayor opposed it. And that was probably the first and last time I agreed with the mayor. But it turns out that the council voted 9-0 to spend the money. And basically 2 years later, we hit the Great Recession. So that moved me to get involved in politics, and that's pretty much why I'm here tonight. And I definitely agree with the idea that, you know, we've got a process in Wallingford that, in my view, is not working well as it relates to the budget, because what we end up with is a budget that ends up taxing citizens. Mm-hmm. And we've done that year in and year out. And that's a concern that I have.
You talked about the original show that you had a few years,
yep,
back. Why don't you give me a little bit of background on that?
Well, interesting enough, it relates again to the subject that we're talking about tonight. We as you know, we've titled this show Wallingford Over the Edge. Well, in the 2010-2011 time frame, myself and a mutual associate, a fellow named Bob Gross, decided that we wanted to create a public television show. Mm-hmm. And we did it right around budget time, which is very similar to this. We named the program Wallingford On the Edge. And the analogy there was we tried to paint a picture that says, if you envision an economic ladder, everyone in town, all families, are on a particular rung of that ladder. Mm-hmm. And in particular, in light of the fact that we were in the midst of the Great Recession, people were losing their houses, seniors were not getting cost of living increases, and of course we didn't get one again this year. People were losing their jobs. And through this entire period, Wallingford chose to continue to raise taxes right through the Great Recession up until today. And we did about, you know, we did about four shows. And the analogy that we tried to create was that, look, if you're sitting on a particular ledge and you get a tax increase 1 year, then you get another tax increase the next year, you're getting closer to the edge of that rung. And pretty soon you get pushed over the edge. And there were people that got pushed over the edge. And so that's the linkage between this show and that show. Basically to say that we're over the edge. We're continuing to do what we've been doing for the last 10 years. And that doesn't bode well for taxpayers.
I think one of the problems is the status of the state. The state is in deep trouble, and as a result of the state being in deep trouble, it's going to start sharing the tax burden.
Yeah.
And this definitely. Year is a good example where they've proposed a few items where, you know, the Wallingford residents are going to have to dish out more money to catch up, to help the state catch up, and that's sad because again we're the ones who are expected to write a check.
The buck stops here at the municipality.
Right. But even if the state doesn't do that, they're going to have to somehow find a way to bring in money anyway. So, you know, you're caught in both directions.
Right.
I guess it'll hurt more at the municipal level for the simple reason that at the municipal level, it's the homeowner who's going to pay through the taxes on their homes.
That's been going on.
Your population of 45,000 people, there's really only 17,000 properties, so that tax burden is going to be hit by the 17,000 owners and businesses and all that good stuff.
The issue of the state is really important because personally, my belief is that we are in a very bad spot at the state level.
Right.
And this is the beginning of a very bad time fiscally. And as you stated, what's happening is that the state, in trying to cut their costs, they're pushing more costs down to the municipalities. On your income taxes, they have taken away the deduction on your income taxes for local property taxes.
Right.
Well, that's a big hit for people. The other thing they're looking at this year, and I don't know whether it's going to happen or not, I think it's going to happen, they're going to take the teacher's pension, which up until now has been held at the state level, and we fund that through our state taxes. They are looking at pushing proportionally that portion of the teachers that teach here in Wallingford, their pension and their liability. They're going to just hand it over to us, which is going to be a big expenditure.
There's the last thing I want to do is defend what the state is doing, but the state is in such a big hole.
It is. It's a huge hole.
It'll have to get money from wherever it can. You've got a bunch of concerns that we talked about over the last couple of days. And spend increases every year.
Yep.
What are your thoughts on that one?
Well, I think it pretty much speaks for itself. I mean, the way the process works today is it's a continuous incline in expenses. And as you increase your expenses, obviously, you're going to need taxes to cover those expenses. And that's pretty much been the game plan of the local body politic here in Wallingford. The way I look at, you know, how much of my taxes have gone up, well, I keep my municipal tax receipts for about 10 years. And I went back about 10 years. I'm paying today, and I'm paying about approximately 40% more in municipal taxes than I did 10 years ago. So if you were paying $5,000 a year 10 years ago, all right, you're paying, $7,000 now.
Right.
You go from
$5,000
to $7,000.
Right.
And it's one thing to say that that's a big number, but when you put the perspective on it that was done during a period of economic slowdown, you know, it makes it flabbergasts you, you know. Why are we doing this? What are we doing to change that? And now that we have the state pushing costs down on us, we've got to start managing the town a little bit differently to minimize that impact. You know,
one of the areas that I have been for the last 3 years, 4 years now, I've been pushing and talking about is to convert a lot of the manual systems to electronic systems.
Absolutely.
Because the biggest cost in this town, the school board is the number one cost, definitely. It's gone up 15% in the last 7 years, possibly a little bit more, 16%. But the town itself stays at the same level when it comes to expenses. And they could eliminate so many expenses by trying to, when they retire people, replace them with automation of some sort.
Right.
But there's no effort whatsoever on the mayor's part. Excuse me for interrupting.
Yeah, it's all right.
Go
ahead.
One of the things that really bothers me is when I look at this year's budget, we're going to take $7 million, I believe, of the reserve so that we don't have to bring taxes up. Why don't we take some of that money to pay for systems, automation, whatever?
Investments.
To invest in the town so that we don't have to do that.
Yeah.
And I don't see that anywhere in the budgets, but, you know.
I have an opinion on that. I totally agree with you that one of the big issues in Wallingford is that we're a status quo town. Nothing has changed. Everything is manual. And, you know, a lot of people have said, wait, we need automation, we need this, we need that. And I agree with that. But it's kind of like the third rail in national politics. Folks look at that and they think, gee, you're going to cut my jobs. And I think that has to be approached in a very people-sensitive way. It's like, if you're going to implement technology, and we should, we have to recognize that you're not going to do that overnight. You do that over time. Mm-hmm. And if we do it in a sensitive way, in a logical way, we can do it without having a major impact on people, because people do retire, they quit or whatever, and you just don't backfill them. But I think that's one of the big pushbacks you get from the political folks, and really even from citizens.
One of the biggest problems is that when they, I remember two elections ago, one and a half elections ago, when Mr. Zandri presented against the mayor, there was a huge push for automation, but they kept talking about email.
Right.
And that's really not automation.
No.
Email is just a form of communications.
Right.
The automation that I'm thinking about is, you know, the bill pay, the GIS systems, the systems that will eliminate people. Email's nice, but email makes it easier for people to communicate.
Yes.
It's not really something that saves positions.
Right.
You know, and so there's ways, I'm sure, that we can go in and we can look at what perfect example is this year. The town bought a snowblower. Sadly, it didn't snow, which is good for us, but but here they went out and they bought a piece of equipment that could help them clear the streets more quickly.
Correct.
With less human interaction.
Mm-hmm.
So those are the types of things that we need to look at and you know, to help manage the budget. I'm going off track here, but certain items you said was like hurting the average homeowner, pushing citizens over the edge, no COLA. I mean, there's a whole pile of things that have happened which is putting everybody under pressure.
Right. Those are all impacts. When you raise taxes every single year, you're hurting people. In particular, you're hurting people on the lower end.
Right.
And we have to strive to make our government more efficient and effective. I know that's your area of expertise. You talked about automation. You've done that professionally. And I think we have to do more of that. But there's also a range of policy issues that we need to take a look at. Things that it's just the way we do business. We've always done this way. And I'll say one thing. in that regard. One of the things we do is we don't have a real formal process. Number one, I don't think we have a good planning process that feeds into the operating process. It's pretty much whatever the council decides. Buildings. The most classic example, which still exists, is Wooding Capling. We purchased that 25 plus years ago. We spent $2 million approximately for it. It still is not developed.
It's interesting because I was thinking of last year when the chief of police talked about a combined 911 center. And one of the things they did is they did spend money to evaluate the if that building could be used.
I remember that, yeah.
I haven't heard a word from that. Have you heard anything?
No,
I mean, that is a good example.
Good example, yeah.
Of where they're again trying to fit this, trying to use a building, a square peg, and they've got a round hole.
Right.
And they were trying to fit the square peg into this round hole, and they spent $35,000, $40,000, whatever it was.
Never heard anything about it, yeah.
But we haven't heard.
Well, the thing is, if you applied the theory I just talked about, before they made that purchase, if somebody had put together a proposal, a comprehensive proposal, after all, we were spending $2 million
right.
that had in it, why are we buying this building? What are we going to do with it? When are we going to do it? Okay, this condition wouldn't exist. We might not have made the purchase either, but that's the whole idea. So we should have a model, a proposal model that anybody that comes before the council has to use this format. And if they don't do the homework, don't come before the council, you're not going to get the money. And we make purchases like that. I think another good example is this cemetery purchase. And I don't have a lot of great detail about it, but we purchased one house, and there was another one, I think, that was, was underwater, it was in foreclosure or something. But the town decided, and to this day, I don't know who originated the idea, that, hey, let's go buy these two houses, and, we need to build a house over there to house equipment, et cetera. And there was no clear vision of where we were headed. Now I'm hearing that there's talk about making it a museum. Here again, there's no process, no plan, and that ends up costing the town a lot of money. I happen to feel
money
that...
Money which we don't have.
Which we don't have.
We don't have any money.
I personally don't think that the town should be spending money on these kinds of purchases, unless there's always an exception, okay, if you can make the case. I don't think we should be spending money on more open space, at least not at the municipal level. Let's go to the state or the feds
to get that
money.
State doesn't have any money. The fed doesn't have any money.
But the point is that we have a finite base of people here. We can't. Mm-hmm. You can't keep making these purchases and having a small group of people pay for it. That's the problem. We already pay for that stuff through the other taxes, and we should use our representatives.
We probably will disagree on this one, but I think we should not spend money for a couple of years to try
we
to
We don't
catch
disagree.
Up.
I agree with that. I definitely agree with
ridiculous.
That point.
So, do you want to talk about the budget process? I mean,
sure.
We're...
What do you think? How do you think it's working?
I mean, the budget process is interesting. It's really, really interesting because, you know, I look at the budget book, and for those of you who haven't seen the budget book, this is an example of the book. It's 100 and some pages of numbers, and the process is such that they have a calendar that they I just received it today. They publish that the mayor puts together the budget, puts it on the table, then the council has departments with all the different meetings, and they question the different department heads and all that good stuff. Then the council makes a recommendation. There's a public hearing which will occur on the 20th of April, and that's where you and I can...
That's right around the corner.
Right next week, where you and I can stand up and question the department heads or anybody as to why this, why that. And then when it's all over and the council is finished, they take a vote and they basically approve the budget.
Right.
And historically, as long as I can remember, the years I've been here, not as long as you, what goes on is that it's a smooth transition from Mr. Bowes producing the budget under the mayor's direction, the mayor presenting the budget, the council sort of kind of rubber stamping the budget.
Good word.
Then the public hearing is just something that is in our charter that they have to do. They don't really listen to anybody. They just sit there and listen to the questions.
Mm-hmm.
And then they approve it.
Yeah, right.
And from year to year to year, we go through and we have the increases. I think I've gone back to, I'm trying to remember now, it was 2003, 2004. And there's been an increase every single year. Since the beginning, since the mayor's been in power, which is some 30 plus
been there
years,
a long time, yeah.
There's never been a flat budget.
No.
It's always been an increased budget.
Yeah.
And it's sad.
It is very sad. The term I use at this point in time is, and I've made this case, I've tried to make this case to the council just as recently as night before last. I think the process that we have has some faults in it. It's a faulty process.
Mm-hmm.
And what happens is, as a result of that process, is that we come out of the other end with a budget where the expense portion of the budget is always overestimated and the revenue portion is always underestimated. And because the expenditures are overestimated, that permits the town to ask for a tax increase.
Right.
Okay? And of course the council approves the tax increase. And then what happens is we find out, unfortunately it's a year plus later, which is when the audit is produced, we find out that we didn't need that tax increase. And by the time we realize that we had this faulty budget, we're into the next budget. So that's been going on for a long time, and I think that's what's been driving the tax increases. And I think I've identified a key element in that process that, if it were fixed, would create a lot more transparency about the proposed budget.
Mm-hmm.
And you might not get it approved. You might get some pushback from the council. And that is specifically the issue that I raised two nights ago with the council, which is, I believe that when the budget is submitted, that the administration is supposed to provide an estimate or a forecast, if you will, of how the current year will end. That becomes the foundation
right.
for next year. Well, the administration doesn't do that, and the mayor acknowledged that. The numbers that are in that column are budget numbers for the year, and we know that those budget numbers are grossly inaccurate.
We're running 2 years behind.
Well,
because if you look at the budget, the columns in the budget, you're looking at the, right now we're in the 217, 218 budget.
Mm-hmm.
The only actuals, the only audited one that we have is the 215,
15,
216.
16. Right.
You know, those are the audited numbers.
Right.
The 15, the 16, 17 numbers, which is what we're currently working under,
mm-hmm.
are total unknown.
Yeah.
I mean, they give us a 7 month window of what they've spent.
Right.
But that isn't a complete window, because at the end of the year, they, as you said, they shuffle things
right.
around and they do this.
Well, that's
and they
why
do that.
That's why you have to have you have to have the administration, and the mayor, I think, carries this responsibility to provide a forecast.
Right.
And it's an estimate. It's not a guarantee, but the projection of how we're going to end the year should be dramatically more accurate now than it was when you first made it 8 months ago, because you've got most of the data available to you. That is a critical foundation to any good budgeting process. And we don't do it. And I think that has to be changed. I think it's in the charter. I've been told that Our legal department looked at it, and they don't agree. It's still an open issue. But I don't even see it as a legal issue. It's just, it's intuitively obvious that that's what you should do.
You and I both come out of the corporate world.
Right.
And in the corporate world, they produce, especially public corporations, private, a lot of private corporations do too, but public corporations will do quarterly reports. And the quarterly yep. reports are basically a summary of what the corporation is doing.
Yep.
You know, is it doing good? Is it losing money? Is it, where is it?
Everybody does it.
And it's a standard thing. The whole world does it.
Yep.
Every corporation in the world does it. And they present it because the shareholders are sitting there saying, what are you doing?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, this town, we're reporting 2 years behind.
Correct.
What is actually happening. So right now, the latest audit report that I could pull out is the 2015-2016 audit report. And there's 180 pages of a report.
That's the only report that we get.
And what I find amazing, when I compare this audit report to the budget book,
mm-hmm.
okay, and the budget book is that document I showed before, the 100 and some pages
right.
budget book, is that the numbers for the 2015-2016 audit report don't appear in the budget book, and that's something I don't understand. Because if it's audited and it's cast in stone, how come they're not transmitted to the current budget book?
Mm-hmm.
You know, so there's really some funny things going on.
Right.
So
right.
no, we don't have the quarterly reports, and we should. Right. And I think you asked about that.
Well, I tried to address that, and I'll tell you, it's interesting to me that this is where you get into the politics of the town. I know for a fact that there are a number of councilors. I won't name any names. I've communicated with them, and they want a macro report, a quarterly report, but they can't get it done. The administration will not provide it. I made that proposal, and the administration came back and said, look, we don't think we need to do that. We're giving you enough information.
This
I don't agree with that.
This is the January report that the councilors get.
Exactly. Okay. That's all they get.
This is 108 pages of
right.
line items.
That's correct.
With no summaries. There's
mm-hmm.
no information in here. It's data. It's raw data.
Right.
Where is the information that the councilors can actually look at and say, Mr. Mayor, why are we running high, or why are we running low, or why are we doing
doesn't
this?
Exist.
And I will guarantee you that if I asked any councilor to tell me what's in one of these, I'm willing to bet that very few, if any, could say, if you go to page so-and-so and you look at line item so-and-so, you will see a problem there.
Right.
Because it is too big, too...
Well, it's...
And it's always late. It's always...
It's totally inappropriate. We keep... The way I view the... And I think most people view it this way. We keep making references to the mayor as the CEO. Okay, I'll buy that. He's the CEO of the town. But the council is the board of directors.
But they're not.
But they're not treated that way.
But they're not. They can't fire the mayor.
Okay. Well, let me make this point because it relates to your comment about the reports. The council is getting what amounts to an accountant's report.
It's
150
data.
Pages.
It's data.
These are individuals who we have entrusted to help manage
right.
the town. These are intelligent people. They should be given macro tools that they can read, executive summaries, if you will.
Right.
Once a month, 4 pages, 5 pages.
Right.
Give them a snapshot of
quarterly report.
Doing. It's not being done. And personally, I think that the council has to stand up and make it happen. They have the power to do it, but then now we get into the politics of the town. And the council is dominated by Republicans. The mayor's a Republican. He's a leader of the Republican Party.
And
I'm not saying it's all partisan. I'm just saying that we have a party system. And when's the last time the mayor was overridden?
Oh, he's not.
Never.
He's not. Let me talk about the...
Go ahead.
The CNR report, capital non-recurring.
Absolutely. Yep.
This is 9 months worth of work.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Back in June of last year, I looked at the CNR, I looked at the monthly report, and I went digging, and I looked at the actual money that was sitting in the bank, and I said, why are we holding money prior to 2010? I mean, isn't that ridiculous that we've got funds sitting here? Right. And I went to the council meeting and I said, can somebody explain this to me? And Mr. Chairman Cerboni and a few others couldn't say it. The mayor stood up and told me about Hall Avenue landscapes or streetscapes. Mm-hmm. And he went on, he talked about it, blah, 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 blah. And I said, I don't buy that. So what I did is I wrote Freedom of Information request to Mr. Bose. He said he wasn't aware. To the mayor, he said he wasn't aware. And finally, I went to the department heads, which is Henry in Public Works and Bob in Engineering. And I sat down with them, and they basically told me what all the line items were. And I came up with a list, and I said, why are we doing this? Like, why do we have this money? Good example of money that was sitting in that fund, which is referred to as assigned, was $500,000 sitting in the fund, $496,402. Sorry, I apologize, that's the different one. $497,000 for Simpson Court parking. Mm-hmm. Now, Simpson Court parking was killed by referendum
a few years ago.
Four years ago. And yet the money to do that work was still sitting in the fund, not being touched, okay? Why is that? Is it a little reserve that somebody is keeping there? The other thing I found interesting is that the Public Works Department, they don't have project plans, they don't have closeout letters, they don't have any way that when they finish one of their projects and there's money left in the fund, to release that money back to the coffers.
Right.
So the money's was sitting there. Anyway, I went through, and I identified 23 line items. The money for the Simpson Court, $10,000 for a bus shelter at Walmart, et cetera, et cetera. That totaled $1.4 million,
mm-hmm,
that has since been returned to the town.
Right.
I don't know where it went. So in 2015, we have $500,000 sitting in the fund from 2015. We've got another $120,000 sitting in the fund from 2016.
Right.
So we've got about $620,000 sitting in the fund for those 2 years that hasn't been touched, hasn't been used yet.
Mm-hmm.
Yet when I looked at this week, at the budget this week, I see that there's $1 million requested again for townwide paving. So now Henry's got to not only spend this year's money, but he's got to spend the 2015 money and the 2016
There's money.
Money
everywhere in the budget.
Right. The point I'm going to make is if we had zero-based budgeting, okay, automatically at the end of the year, money that's not spent would go back into the kitty, right, and now we would have money to use, additional money to use this year, which would maybe prevent some of the tax
Absolutely.
Increases. So it's the budget process has got so many holes in it.
So we have the budget process, like we just talked about, that creates these tax increases. But when it comes to the business practices that we have that are costing us a tremendous amount of money that we should be dealing with and we're not dealing with them, one of them is the pension fund.
Yes.
The pension fund in Wallingford, now this is a problem in almost all municipalities in the state. They're underfunded. The pension fund in Wallingford, as of this past year, was $65 million unfunded. Now, that's a futures number. You look at it, you say, well, it's $65 million, but you know, this is paid out over time. But what happens as a result of that is, based on the design of the program, is that when we fall behind on our pension through unfunded liabilities, the town is required to contribute more to try to make it up. Mm-hmm. And I think you have data on this. If you look at the pension contributions, you go 10 years ago, we were paying $2 million a year was our contribution. This now the actuarial says we should be contributing $8 million this year. And I think we contributed like 7.5 last year. So what's happening is our contribution is going, it's going out of control. And what's happening is,
well, we're not keeping up.
We're not keeping up.
Right.
That money is going into the pension fund, into the stock market and the bond market, and it's being lost. And we're paying for it. So we have to fix the pension fund. If we fix the pension fund, we will see a reduction in annual, think about this, annual expenses of $5 million a year. $5 million. Because we don't need to be contributing $8 million. The only reason we are is we're behind the curve.
Right.
We would be contributing, if we had a defined contribution plan, and I know this is controversial, but that's what you have in the private sector, and some municipalities have done that too, is that we could construct a beautiful defined contribution plan and match funds dollar for dollar, and the individual would own their own pension. But we have this pension system, to some extent we're stuck because the state is heavily involved in mandating how we do this. But it's costing us $5 million extra a year.
The number this year that's in the budget book is $7.768 million.
Right.
I mean, that is a huge amount of money.
That represents,
but it's interesting what you just said, because in 2011 we were contributing 5.2.
Yeah.
And we've grown to 7.7. That's a $2.5 million per year.
Right. You go back
increase.
Even further, you'll see it's,
oh, I know.
It's
it
like
used
this.
To be.
Yeah.
It was in the $2 million range.
Yep.
And then all of a sudden in the 2008, 2009 time frame.
That's what I mean about a problem that is, it's growing, and we can't even get anybody to talk about it. Although I will say, after making this recommendation to the council, Mr. Testa, Vinny Testa, has responded and said, hey, I was thinking about putting that on the agenda. I'm looking forward to hearing about that.
Right.
He's going to put it on the council agenda. They're going to put it out in the open, have a conversation about it, talk about what we might do to resolve this issue in the long term. It's a ticking time bomb.
It's interesting because when I look at the budget, and I don't have the chart here, but if we look at Parks and Recreation,
mm-hmm.
They haven't had a raise in 7 or 8 years. They're flat. Their expenses are totally flat. And yet, the number of children we have in this town is pretty flat also. So they're holding their own. They're dealing with increased salaries and all that good stuff without raising their costs. Public safety has gone up a bit, which is fair, because I think public safety...
It's very important.
Extremely important. That's the primary reason why we have a town.
Yeah.
As public safety, as fire.
And public works, you got to have public works.
And to us, not as important as the police. The police and fire
are number
one.
Yeah, I would agree that health and safety is the most important.
That's the number one. The number two is public works. And
yeah.
Public works has been pretty flat.
Yeah, they have.
What is interesting is that the general government expense is the one that's been going up.
Mm-hmm.
And it's been going up quite substantially. General government in 2011 was $21 million. Today it's $25 million.
Right.
I don't know what the current is because I don't have.
Well,
the,
I can comment on that. I have
the audited one, but it's so we've gone up about $6 million.
Correct.
In the last 4, 6, 8 years.
Yeah.
As compared to everybody else who's basically stayed the same.
Yeah.
Why is that? Well, my own opinion is that we are spending a lot of money on things that we may not need.
I agree with that.
Okay.
There's three areas that if the council and the mayor were committed to this, to resolving this and to doing things a little different, we could save millions. I've already mentioned the pension.
Mm-hmm.
That's $5 million. That's a controversial issue, but it has to be addressed. How do you address it? Well, you put it on the table and get everybody involved in it. Let's have a conversation about it. Let's acknowledge that it's a problem and they're willing to work on it. That's $5 million. There's another area that I've been at odds with this administration with for the last 5 years. And it does have to do with the capital non-recurring and capital spending. This administration has
the bonding.
What I would consider an unhealthy obsession.
You're right.
With avoiding issuing bonds or debt. And so what they do is, all of this taxes and all these extra dollars, including the electric division, they pay cash for big ticket items instead of issuing bonds and paying them off over 20 or 30 years. This has been brought up a number of times. The administration and the mayor's taken a position. They say, well, we don't want that debt. Well, the reality is that when you, it's like buying a house. When you went to buy your house, you didn't pay cash for it.
Oh, yeah.
You couldn't pay cash. Well, maybe you did, but I didn't. Most people have to take a mortgage or a bond. You pay that back in inflated dollars. So what you're actually doing is you get the money, you buy the item, it has a 30-year lifespan, you pay it off over the life of the item, and you're paying it back in inflated dollars. Mm-hmm. So it's debatable as to whether it costs you anything. In fact, you may even make money on the situation. That's why a company like Apple Computer, they have billions of dollars on their balance sheet. They don't use that. They borrow because they can get a very low interest rate. We have a AAA rating. We pay a very low fee. But this mayor does not want to do it. And the impact of that is you have to pay that up front. It's coming from you and me. $5 million, considering the number of households that you just mentioned, 15,000, 16,000.
Yeah.
The average homeowner is, for that $5 million, is paying about $350 of their tax bill just so the town can pay cash for an item that they should bond. That is so wrong-headed. If they change that, you'd see a reduction, again, in annual cost of $5 million. So now you get the pension funds five. Here's another five for cash. Now, what's the impact? Well, guess what? Our bond, we'd have more bonds outstanding. This town, we are authorized by the state to issue bonds. And they look at things financially, and they say, for a town your size, you can support bonding, this is Wallingford, up to $900 million. I'm not advocating that we borrow $900 million. We are borrowing, right now, our bonding is around $30 million. I would advocate, look, the council should set the bond limit. Set it where you want it. If you say, okay, look, let's set it at $80 million. Which is really a pittance. It's 8%. That means that they're going to authorize the town to borrow up to $80 million for bona fide capital items. And the impact on the taxpayer is dramatic because you're only paying the interest.
You're talking about bonding, and that's just one of the many ways you can not spend your cash.
Correct.
I mean, I look,
and it's a valid tool. That's the point.
Right, but there are other tools. I look at New Haven, the town of New Haven, and what they did over the last couple of years, because they were in a cash crunch like everybody else, is they started to lease some of their larger equipment, like a fire truck.
There you go.
Okay, so they had a 5-year lease, a 5-year lease with a balloon payment at the end, so that they don't have to dish out that $400,000 up front.
Yep.
They leased it, they paid in chunks, and then they did a balloon payment. Why don't we do things like that? We're buying an ambulance, we're buying a fire truck, we're
leadership.
Buying, I mean, these are very simple things that we can do that eliminate the requirement for cash.
Cash, yep.
And it allows us to not raise the taxes again.
And one other item we do, it goes back to this capital non-recurring. We should not be doing this. It's not appropriate. Taking the electric division pilot money, which is a payment in lieu of taxes, and using it to buy capital items is inappropriate. And the reason is that is recurring income. That money comes in every single year. Just like my taxes come in every year, just like your taxes, that money should be used for operations instead of putting it in that fund. That's another $200 off your tax bill. So we've identified really, $12 million.
Oh.
If we would just take action on these things. And I think that with the right leadership and the right headset, I think, or maybe changing some minds, it might begin to happen. So
I am really sometimes very frustrated because there's so many different ways that this town could finance its purchases, could bond it for, you know, for
yep.
buildings, for things like that, where you could use the bonding issue for equipment, you know, public works equipment, fire department equipment. We could actually lease with balloon payments. I mean, there's a whole pile of different ways that we could do it.
Yeah.
The other thing, and I know this is a personal thing, is the money that we dish out to different organizations in the town. Yeah. I mean, a lot of it, I think, is money that when we are under difficult times, like right now, we're in the difficult mm-hmm. times. If we have to use $7 million out of our reserves to
well, we're not really going to use that, but
well,
that's all right.
If we are.
That's, well, I know, but that's the issue of the fake budget. Well, no, seriously, as you know, when we talked about, if you look at the trends on the budget, what has happened is, if you look, we have data that we're going to present as
right.
part of this that shows that for the last 5 years, we have not touched a penny of the fund balance, the quote-unquote fund balance money that is put in the budget. In
right.
other words, every year, the administration says, hey, look, we're going to take $4.2 million out of our surplus, and we're going to use it to fund some of this new
right.
budget.
And we keep replacing it.
They never use it.
Right. We replace it all the time.
Correct.
Right.
So they never use the 4.2 because the budget is so inaccurate.
Right.
So, and like I said, this year the mayor is saying, well, we're going to put 7.2 in, but we still want a tax increase. I predict that we will not use 7.2 million, and in my opinion, the budget for next year is a minimum of $3 million too high on the expense side, based on fiscal trends. That's my prediction. It's on tape. Let's see if it happens. I also feel that this year we are not going to come in at 155.7 million on the expense line. We're going to come in with something less than that. I think I'm trying to think of the number. I've got it written down somewhere. But it's going to be less. We're going to have a surplus again of about $6 million in this year's budget.
But that's not the real surplus, because the real surplus, they use a lot of the money that is surplus to do things. And
right.
And unfortunately, like if I look at the...
Well, they spend the money. What
right.
they do is they
spend,
keep the balance there,
right,
but
right.
they spend the extra on
right,
buying this
because
and buying that.
If I look at the fund balance, the actual fund balance for the town,
yeah.
okay, starting in 2011, we had $20,962,000, and as of 2016, we had $29,250,000, and that increases by about $2 million a year. Some years $1 million, but
right.
an average of, you know, 1.5, $2 million a year.
Mm-hmm.
I don't have the 2016, 2017 numbers because, again, we're lagging behind, and that won't be available till December
right.
of this year, and
yep.
then we're talking about the 2017, 2018 numbers. So we have a huge amount of cash sitting there.
Yeah, we do.
That we could be using to,
and we should be using that. That money belongs to the taxpayers of Wallingford.
Right.
We should spend that money down because it belongs to the taxpayer, and we should have a tight fiscal budget in this
right.
town. And if we did that, and if we did some of the other things we talked about in terms of solving problems that we know exist, they're not easy to solve, but you have to deal with them or they just keep getting bigger. If we don't do that, we're in for a very difficult period. I'm talking about taxpayers. We are presenting, as we did, as you know, we talked about the chart. I call it the fat budget chart. And what it shows is that for the last 5 years, we have generated a surplus in every year,
right.
anywhere from a low of 6.1 to a high of 7.2 million, every single year. the expense side of the equation have had a an average of 3.4 million every year. Those are huge numbers, and we have to get on top of this. We have in this case, what's happening is there's a budget overreach, if you will, and we're letting it happen, and as a result, more and more taxes are being laid on the average homeowner.
So what do you think people need to do?
Well, that gets back to why are we here tonight? We want to make sure people, we hope that people will be, as a result of listening to what we have to say, will believe that it's credible and we're sincere, and that they'll take an interest in looking into how the town's being managed. More specifically, as you mentioned, we have the budget. We're going through the budget right now. You have an opportunity to go to the meeting on the 20th and express yourself. You know, if you feel that you're being overtaxed, tell them. You can call the mayor. You can call your counselors. Get involved is the key thing. And of course, you can also run for office. That's a big decision, but running for office, I mean, you did it, which I think you're to be commended for. Last year, and you got a big chunk of votes for somebody that hadn't been in town that long. And I really think that, to be honest with you, I think that the long-term fix has to involve changes to the charter.
Yes.
There's one thing in the charter that is a major problem, and it really gives the mayor almost dictatorial power. The only way that the town council can override him is by getting 7 out of the 9 votes. That is ridiculously high. In my opinion, it should be changed. It should go down to 5. Make it democratic. A lot of people feel 6. I say, my view, make it 5. Let's make it the council more democratic, because the counselors can feel that, hey, if I raise an issue and really push an issue and convince one or two of my counselors, we can make something happen.
Right.
But today, I think there's a sense of futility. There's a, why bring it up? Because we can never override the mayor. That has to change, but that's going to be a long-term fix.
If I remember correctly, the charter states that if the council can't reach agreement on a budget, that the budget goes through anyway.
Yes.
Which, again, is something that I don't think should be. I think it should be, if they can't reach agreement, it should probably go back to last year's budget.
Yeah, I would agree with that.
We should not automatically approve increases without having really discussed them.
Yeah.
And if our council says something's wrong,
we can't agree, then
we
can't
agree.
Yeah.
I mean, the charter is so poorly written.
The thing is, it was written, and I don't want to be too critical of it, because I think, as we both know, we both said, Wallingford's a great town.
Mm-hmm.
I love living in Wallingford. That's why I live here. It's a great town, and we have a few issues, and one of them is the way we're being governed. I think
Right. We're
paying too many taxes. We're in a tough situation, and we have to tighten up the process and be more efficient and effective. But the charter was written in the '60s, and if you think about that. The people, and I'm not being critical of any person per se. I'm just saying that the people that wrote the charter, they would have had an experience from the Depression.
Mm-hmm.
If you assume that they're, middle-aged people, maybe people in their 50s or 60s or whatever, they have a Depression-era valid perception. And that's how they wrote the charter. They translated that. That's how they wrote it into the charter, and they put some tight constraints in place, thinking that they were doing the right thing, and I'm sure they were doing the right thing at the time. But one of the mechanisms that the administration has, and it's in the charter, is they have the ability to make law. They write ordinances all the time, and they look at the charter. Some of it's gray. They decide to bend it, the way that they want to interpret it, and they write an ordinance.
Right.
And, I mean, that's just the way the world works, but I'm just saying we're going to have to change that in the long term, I believe. So.
We had fun.
I think so. I really hope folks will, number one, watch, and then secondarily, you know, get involved. This is pretty much similar to what Bob Gross and I did in 2010. We made the same appeals, and hopefully, we got some good feedback on it, and hopefully we'll do the same here. Who knows, maybe we'll do another show.
The meeting is on the 20th at Town Hall. I think everybody needs to go. I think we need to fill the chambers.
Boy, that would be great.
And we need to get out there and talk to the mayor and to the council and basically say enough is enough. We need to hold the line for a number of years.
I agree.
So anyway, I really enjoyed...
Me too.
Enjoyed this discussion.
We may do it again.
Okay.
Good night.